Welcome to Suburban.
Good morning. We're the King family, and we are just happy to be together with you guys as a church today. Even though we're disappointed that we have to do all the services online now, there's still a lot to be thankful for.
Yeah, lately we've been writing things that we're thankful for on our windows. There are a lot of things we're thankful for, and one of them is church.
Right here, big and underlined. So join us together as we're all thankful that God is still on the throne and that we can worship him together this morning.
All right, good morning, church. Good morning, another morning to come together as a church body, as a church family, and to worship the Lord. And so we're going to do that this morning. We're going to sing a song that says, "Give thanks to the Lord." And so let's do that this morning. Let's give thanks. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. And for his good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. We sing praise. We sing praise. We sing praise. We sing praise. We sing praise.
Forever God is strong. Forever God is. Together this morning, God, we thank you that we can come before your throne this morning and worship you, lift our voices to you, that we can proclaim your truths, that we can hold on to your promises and proclaim your promises, and that's what we do this morning, God. We know that you are here in our midst, God. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
You are here. moving in on him. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
You are here.
You are here moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are.
We make miracle work. Promise keep light in the dark. my name is Cassia Hobbs, and I'm excited to share this communion thought with you. With Christmas approaching, I was thinking back to when I was growing up. I went to school at Zion Lutheran School here in Corvallis from preschool through eighth grade, and every year we had a Christmas choir concert. And in my younger elementary days especially, our choir director was super strict. She wanted us to stand straight and tall and face forward and hands down at our sides and not mess around and certainly not wave at our parents. And that just didn't work for my mom. She wanted to be able to signal me somehow. So we worked up a secret signal of I would scan the crowd and find her and lock eyes with her and brush my bangs out of my face. And she would do the same. And that was our secret signal of, I see you and I love you. And, you know, even now, years later, here at church, I'll be up in front of the church and, you know, praying or doing whatever. And I'll see my mom out in the crowd smiling, brushing her bangs out from her face. I see you and I love you. And, you know, it's just such a wonderful, wonderful reminder to have that. And, you know, 2020 has been a hard year, and that's just an understatement. 2020 has been really, really, really hard and really, really, really a lot for all of us. You know, things aren't going our way. Things are hard. There's a lot of unmet expectation and lack of socialization and things that are just leaving us lonely and isolated and feeling like our needs aren't being met. We're not feeling seen and we're not feeling loved. And you know, today as we come to communion, I just want to remind you that that isn't the case with Jesus. Jesus sees us and Jesus loves us. And we know from scripture that Jesus loves us individually and personally. We know that he knows the number of hairs on our head. He knows when we wake up and he knows our hearts. And we know that Jesus loves us because Jesus is love. His very being is love. John 4:16, it says that God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. And that God doesn't just love you like he loves all of his people. He loves you individually and personally. He sees you. He looked out over the course of time and creation and he saw you and he chose you and he loves you and he wants a relationship with you individually and personally. And he invites us into a relationship with him. Beyond just knowing that we exist and loving us, he wants a relationship with us. He doesn't want us to be alone. He wants us to feel seen and loved. And, you know, you may never look out into a crowd and see God looking at you, smiling and brushing his bangs out of his face, but he did give us the ultimate signal reminder of our love, which is the cross. You know, Jesus up on the cross, from the height of the cross, he looked out and he saw you. And he showed that he loved you, not by moving his bangs, but from the blood he shed and from the sacrifice that his body made, he showed that he loved you. And so as we come to communion today, let us remember that reminder of that he sees us and he loves us. He loves you. He loves you individually. Just as you are, he sees you and he loves you. So would you pray with me today? God, it is extremely humbling to think that the God of creation and the universe sees me, loves me, and wants a relationship with me. But that's exactly what you offer us. God, I'm so thankful for this communion time when we get to be reminded of the greatest act of love there has ever been. I pray that when we are feeling lonely and unloved, that we remember that you on the cross and the reason that you endured that for us was that so we could never be alone, and you did that all because of your great love for us, and help us know that we are just more loved than we could ever, ever possibly imagine, that you are there for us through 2020 and beyond, and you'll be there with us always. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Good morning, church. My name is Rob Braun, and I'm one of the elders here at Suburban. I've got an announcement for you this morning. You may recall the informational meeting that we had in September, or perhaps you had a chance to watch that online. During that meeting, we talked about a couple actions that would be coming forward in November. The first of those is to put together a nominating committee to review potential nominations for elder candidates. We're pleased to announce that is in progress, and we'll have some information to share on that in the next week or two. Second part of that action was to seek input from the congregation for suggesting names of potential elders. There's a document in the church office that can be sent out to you. One is called the Elder Qualifications, and the other is Roles and Responsibilities for an Elder. So if you'd like some more information, you can get a copy of that from the office. We'd like you to review those documents, review scripture, think about names of potential candidates, pray about it, and then once you have names you'd like to suggest, feel free to contact any elder or send that into the office. Once the nominating committee information is made available to you, you'll also be free to contact any one of the nominating committee members. So thank you in advance for your input. Hopefully you know that Thanksgiving is coming up. The year's just flown by for me. Thanksgiving is Thursday. So I'd like to start off with a scripture. It's in 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. So I've been just thinking about the situation we're in, and some days I wake up finding myself down a little bit. Maybe you do too. But as soon as I think of all the things God's done for us, it immediately improves my outlook on life. And so today I've got a challenge for you. We're going to do, even though this is pre-recorded, we'll have interactive prayer. So right now I want you to think about something that you are thankful for, that you're going to be willing to share. And then in the middle of the prayer, I'll stop for about 15 or 20 seconds with some quiet time. At that point, I want you to pray, whether you're by yourself or in a group. I want you to verbally speak out what you're thankful for. And if you have a larger group, or if you want to continue on and pray for other things individually, you're free to do that. Just press the pause button on the video stream, and when you're done praying, you can just pick that up and you won't miss any part of the service. So hopefully you're ready for this. We'll try to experiment. Let's go to prayer, and I'll cue you when to pray. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you. We thank you for sending your Son, salvation that we have through you. Without that, we would be lost, Lord. So we thank you for the hope that we have in you. We thank you for the new life that we have. Lord, we thank you for this church body and the lives that have been touched here. We thank you for the members that are active, even though we're distributed and dispersed. People are still actively praying. They're reaching out to each other. And we thank you for the financial blessings that you've continued to provide for us. So go ahead now in your groups and please speak out what you're thankful for. Father, even though you're thankful, we have so many reasons to be thankful. I know that there are still people that are hurting, Lord. So I think of people that have recently lost loved ones. It's a difficult time at any point, but during the holiday seasons, it can cause extra grief, Lord. So we pray that your Spirit would be there with them. Just bring them comfort and bring people alongside to encourage them. Lord, I know there are people that are battling illnesses. Lord, we thank you for the strength you give us to continue on, your mercy and your grace. We thank you for the medical conditions that we have where we can get treatment. Lord, we pray that these treatments would be effective. And Lord, just encourage these people as they go day by day. We pray for healing in their lives, Father. This environment has been very strange for business. Lord, some businesses are doing well. Others maybe not so well. So I know there are people out there that may be looking for work, or they have partial hours, they've been furloughed, Lord. Pray that you'd provide work for them, meet their financial needs, and bless them, Father. Lord, we also think about missions. We think of that going off to some other country all around the world. But this week, we pray for a missionary just down the street from us. We pray for Jake Moivau at Southside Youth Outreach, Lord. We pray that you would be with him, be with the ministry there, the multiple staff that are there. Lord, bless them. We pray for the students and the youth that are coming there. Lord, we pray that they will be touched, they will come to know you, and that they will serve you. Lord, we pray that this ministry will make a big difference in their lives and give them a stable foundation as they go forward and grow into adults. Father, each week we also pray for a local church that we can minister with. This week we're praying for Stan and Glenda Baker. This is a Crossroads Christian Fellowship. Lord, it was just about a year ago this time I was at that church, and they were doing a Christmas concert. They'd reached out to OSU and the high schools and the middle schools. Lord, I know they have a heart for this community, and I know there probably won't be a concert this year, Lord, but I pray that you give them creative ways to continue to reach out to the community. We pray that you bless them, encourage them. We pray for that church. Lord, we thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for moving in our midst. Amen. So last part, you never probably don't get homework out of a prayer, but this week I've got some homework for you. So what I've got in store is I would like you, not only what we did today with the thanks, but each day, each morning, wake up each day, just one thing. Just give thanks to the Lord before you start your day, and hope that will make a difference in your life.
Hey, today we are finishing up a sermon series that we started a few weeks ago where we are looking together at the New Testament book of Romans. So Romans is a letter that was written by an early Christian leader named Paul somewhere around the year 57 AD to a group of Christians who were living in Rome, the capital of the Roman Empire. And in this series, we've been looking primarily at the last few chapters of that letter, because it's in those chapters that Paul really talks about how the power of God can make a difference in practical ways in our day-to-day lives. And time again in this series, we have come back to one idea that really is at the core of the Christian life. See, on our own, we don't have the strength to follow Jesus. And all throughout Romans, Paul reminds us of this truth. We need the power that only God can provide to live the lives that he invites us to live. And in the first 11 chapters of the letter, Paul talks at length about how God, motivated by his love for us, provides us with the Holy Spirit, right? He sends Jesus to die in our place so that as we put our trust and faith in him, we can receive this power that we need. We receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God's own empowering presence in our lives. See, God is so gracious with us that he actually provides us with the power that we need to live the lives that he's calling us to live. And relying on that power, relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, is one of the keys to living lives that are faithful to God. But in this letter, Paul actually gives us another really key thing, another gift that God gives us. It is another incredibly important thing that our gracious God provides us that can help us live the Christian life well. It's something that can encourage us when we're down. It's something that can sustain us in difficulties, that can inspire us to keep going no matter what the world may throw at us. And it's exactly what we're going to be talking about today. It's an essential, but I think often overlooked part of the Christian life. So we're going to dig into that today. But to get started with that, I want to invite you to turn with me in the Bible to Romans chapter 13. So last week, we started looking at a passage in Romans chapter 12 where Paul's talking about love. It's one of these things, he's talking about love, and he talks about how love should transform every relationship in our lives. And then at the beginning of chapter 13, he starts to talk about how Christians should relate with the government. And in fact, that passage where it talks about Christians and the government, we discussed that. We had a wonderful conversation about that in the deep dive that we hosted on Zoom this week. And if you weren't able to join us for that, but are interested in exploring that topic a little bit more in depth, you can find the deep dive video on our YouTube page. I would encourage you to check that out. But when you're reading along, right, so Paul's talking about love should transform our relationships, and then you get to this part about the government, and it's almost like, wait, Paul, did you just take a detour here? I mean, why are we talking about that? But it turns out that he's not taking a detour. What's going on here, what he says about the government is actually a part of the larger overall argument that he's making. And this is one of those places in the Bible where our chapter and verse divisions, they don't do us any favors. Now, we need to remember that the numbers that we see when we read the Bible, the chapter and verse, those weren't part of the original text. Those were added centuries later as a way to help Christians kind of navigate their way through a really long text. And sometimes they work really well and they're helpful. And then in some situations like this one, they actually can kind of muddy the waters. Because the fact that there's a chapter break right there at 13 makes us think that Paul's moving on to a new topic. But really, he's still in the same topic. Everything that you see from verse 9 of chapter 12 through the end of chapter 13 is one topic in Paul's mind. You can kind of see how it plays out, right? So he starts this passage out talking about love in chapter 12, verse 9. And then he talks about how love should transform our relationship with Christ. Then he talks about how love should transform our relationship with people in the church. And then he gives two examples of how love should transform our relationship with people out in the community. First, he talks about how it should transform our relationship with our enemies. And then he talks about how it should impact the way we interact with the government. And then Paul circles back to where he started to finish out chapter 13 by talking once again about love. Love is the bookend at the beginning of the end that helps you see that for Paul, this is all part of one larger argument that he's going to make. So today we're going to look at how Paul concludes this argument, that part of chapter 13. So what I want us to do is jump in at verse 8 and see how he transitions from this topic of talking about the government to talking about love. So just before this, he's been talking about how Christians should pay their taxes to the government. And because he's been talking about taxes and finances, he just kind of keeps that language going. So look what he says starting in verse 8. He says, "Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law." Now, it's a pretty nifty little kind of linguistic move Paul does there. He's like, oh, we're talking about money, huh? Well, let no debt remain outstanding, except, of course, for the debt they have to each other. You know, he says you really should pay off the debts and what you owe people in the world. But he says in the church, there's another kind of debt, the debt of love that we owe each other. And that's not a one and done kind of thing. That is an ongoing, continual debt or obligation that we have to others within the church. And I got to tell you, this is kind of a frustrating passage for a person like me. Now, I've told you all before, I love to-do lists, right? I love making them, and I really love crossing things off of them. And I know other to-do list people out there, we have found each other and we've talked. And I know that some of you are like me, where if you end up doing something during the day that wasn't on the to-do list you made that morning, you actually go back and you write it down on your to-do list, even though you've already done it, just so that you can get the joy of crossing that sucker off. I mean, for me, I love crossing stuff off to-do lists because I like feeling like something is done. But part of what Paul says in this passage is that not everything in the Christian life works that way, right? So it's not like we see a Christian brother and sister who's down and we go over and we say some encouraging words to him, and then we walk home and we look at our to-do list and we say, oh, love one another. I'm going to check that one off. I'm done with that till eternity because I said that encouraging word. No, Paul says in some things, you got to continue to do this. We have an ongoing obligation, a continuing debt to love one another. It's not a bill we ever pay off. And then Paul keeps going. He keeps building on that idea. And he builds on that by saying this. He says, "For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law." Now, what does exactly that mean, the idea that love fulfills the law? Well, let's talk about that for a second. When Paul says that somehow love fulfills the law, that's not an idea that's original to him. He's actually just quoting and building on something that Jesus himself taught. So at one point when Jesus was teaching, somebody goes up to him and says, "Jesus, you know, there's so many laws in the Old Testament. There's 613 of them. What's the most important one?" And Jesus answers by saying, well, there's actually two, right? The most important thing in the Old Testament, you've got to love God with everything you've got, and you got to love your neighbor. And then he ends up saying this afterwards. After saying that line, he says this. He says, oh, and by the way, all of the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. You see, for Jesus, if someone truly loved God and truly loved others, then the kinds of things that they're doing as they're loving God and loving others are naturally going to fulfill these other laws. They're naturally going to live out the intention of all these other more specific laws. And Paul really latches onto that idea, and he embraces it, and he talks about it a lot in his letters. So, for example, in a different one of his letters to the church in Galatia, he says this. He says, "For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself." And that idea of love fulfilling the law, he shows that shows up in the passage we're looking at today in two places. It actually bookends it. He starts and he ends with it. So at the beginning, he says, "For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law." And then he goes on and he starts to show how some of the specific laws, like from the Ten Commandments in the Old Testament, are actually fulfilled if you love one another. So he says the commandments, "You shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not covet." And whatever other command there may be, those are summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. And then he rounds this section out by going back to the idea of fulfillment. He says, "Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law." You see, both for Jesus and for Paul, if somebody truly loved God and truly loved others, the actions that they did out of motivated by love of God for others are going to naturally fulfill the intention of all those other laws. And that's why for followers of Jesus today, in a sense, we've got it really easy. Whenever we've got a decision to make or we face a situation and we're not sure what to do, we don't have a list of rules that's 600 some long that we've got to go back and consult. Instead, because the whole law is fulfilled in loving God and others, we can just ask ourselves one simple question. What does love require of me? Right? What does love require of me? Given that the entire law is fulfilled in loving God and loving others, what does love require that I do in this particular situation? Given that the Holy Spirit of God lives in me and is going to empower me to actually do what love requires, what does love require of me to do given what I'm facing here? Given the fact that I'm supposed to love other people in the same way that God has loved me, what does love require of me? Now that is such a simple question to ask. But anybody who has ever asked that question before knows that it's not necessarily an easy question to actually answer and to live out, especially. Sometimes we know what love requires, it's just really hard. And in fact, that's one of the things that Jesus talks about. If you look at Jesus' teaching, he makes it really clear that while we just have this one command to follow, that if we truly do what love requires of us, it's actually going to be more demanding and more difficult than what the law says. It's almost like the law was the bare minimum, and love builds on that and what it requires. So Jesus, for example, in the Sermon on the Mount, gives example after example of what that looks like. So in one passage, he says this. He says, "You have heard it said, that it was said to people long ago, you shall not murder," right? That was the law. You shall not murder. "But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. And anybody who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell." Now, you see what Jesus is doing here? He's really kicking it up a notch. I mean, honestly, for most of us, it would be pretty easy to go through the day and not murder anyone. I mean, can you imagine you get to the end of the day and you're like, yeah, made it through the whole day. Didn't kill a single person. Totally nailed this Jesus life today. But Jesus says, no, you know, not so fast, my friend. Like, it's not just about the letter of the law. Really, what love requires of you goes into what's going on in your heart. It's more complicated than that. So this is not just about not murdering someone. He says, if you've even gotten so angry with somebody that you would call them a fool, you're kind of on thin ice. And now, I don't know about you all, but I read that and I realize that I'm on thin ice a lot. I'm on thin ice pretty much every time I go to any one of my kids' sporting events and I watch the ref blow a call. Because it's sometimes with my mouth, but definitely in my heart, I'm thinking that person is a fool. I'm on thin ice pretty much every time I get on social media and see what people are saying to each other. I mean, is it just me? Is anybody else out there ever called somebody a fool, at least in their mind, maybe with their words? Yeah, we have done that. And so for me, when I read this and I see how Jesus is kind of leveling it up, how he's making it even more demanding with this, what does love require of me? And I just realize how often I fall short. Even though I have the Holy Spirit's power inside of me, I still don't get it right sometimes. Even though there's only one law to follow, right? Just love each other. I still don't get it right. And when I realize how often I fall short in this, it can get very discouraging. And I think Paul realizes in his letter that for followers of Jesus, us today, the Romans back in, even though we have access to God's Holy Spirit's power living in us, it is really hard to love other people. And when we fall short or when we see what the challenges are that are involved in that, we can get discouraged. So that's why in the next verses, starting in verse 11, Paul lets us in on another really key thing that can help us. So look what he says starting in verse 11. He says, "And do this, understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here." Now again, look at how the passage starts. He says, "And do this." Well, what is Paul referring back to when he says, "And do this"? What's he talking about? Well, he's talking about the fact that we are supposed to fulfill the law by relying on God's power to truly love other people. He says, that's what you got to do. So he says, and you should do that understanding this present time. Right? So there's something about the present time that we live in that he connects to the idea of loving God and loving others. Right? There's something about the present time that we live in that can help us live out the command to love each other. So what is significant about that present time? I mean, what is Paul actually talking about here with, you know, the day is almost over in the night and, you know, what Paul is talking about is the fact that Christians live in this really unique time. right? We live in the era between the time when Jesus came and lived on this earth and the time when Jesus promises to return and rule this earth and put this broken world back together again. And that is the language that Paul is using here. That's what he's talking about when he says our salvation is nearer now than when we first believe, right? The day that Jesus is going to come back is nearer now than it was when we first believe. It's what he's getting at when he says the night is nearly over, right? This time without him, and the day is almost here. So oftentimes you hear people talk about the experience of Christians in this present time using the words already and not yet, right? We live between the times where Jesus has already come. He has already impacted and transformed human history, but he has not yet returned to fully and finally establish God's kingdom. Our present time exists in between those two moments. And think about what it means for us as followers of Jesus that we live in between those two moments. Right? Think about when Jesus came the first time, he faced the brokenness and the pain of this world head on, and he triumphed over them by the cross. But then he left, and he promised that one day he would come back and finish the job and rule the world. Now that day is coming, but it hasn't come yet. So Jesus says, hey, in this meantime, before I come back, I'm leaving you with the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that's what can help you truly live the life I'm calling you to live in this in-between time. But he also knew that it wouldn't be easy to do that, which is why he tells his disciples, hey, in this world, you will have troubles. He knew that there would be times where it would not be easy to love others. But he gave us his power to do that. And he gives us encouragement to know that the battle has been won and that one day he's coming back. And those things together can help us. And one of the most helpful ways for me personally, I'm kind of a history buff, to think about what it's like to live in this time between the first coming and the second coming of Jesus and how that impacts our life today is to think about it in terms of history. Think about it in terms of World War II and the difference between D-Day and VE Day, Victory in Europe Day. So a New Testament scholar once was talking about this, and he said that a good way to understand the difference between the first coming and the second coming of Christ is to think about them in terms of D-Day and VE Day. So think about D-Day, right? June 6, 1944, the Allied forces land at Normandy. And after paying just an incredible price in terms of the lives of people who made that sacrifice, they are able to establish a beachhead. And finally, they've got a way to move troops and supplies into Europe. And most historians, when they look back at the history of the World War II, they point to D-Day as the day that the war was over. Right? They said, okay, at that point, there's still a lot of work to do. But at that point, once the Allies had a beachhead, they had a way to move just a tremendous amount of people and supplies and weapons and soldiers into Europe. Like once they had that beachhead, there was no way that the Nazis were going to be able to fight against all of the resources that the Allies could now bring to bear and bring into the European theater. There was no way that the Nazis were going to be able to win the war at this point. However, almost a full year passed between D-Day and the day that the Nazis ended up surrendering, right? What we know as Victory in Europe Day. And just as D-Day marked the beginning of the end for the Nazis, the death and resurrection of Jesus signaled that the kingdom of God had fought its way into this world and had established a beachhead here in our broken world. But just like the Allied troops still had a lot of work to do between D-Day and VE Day, there is still a lot of work for us to do as we follow Jesus in this world. Yes, he has triumphed over death on the cross, but until he comes back, there's going to be work for us to do. And some of that work is really challenging work to do because it involves spiritual warfare and it involves loving other people, right? And we have to keep up this fight, but we know we can do that because we know that the outcome of the battle is not in question, right? We know where this is going. We know that God wins. And that's the idea that I was talking about at the beginning of this sermon when I said that there are two keys to really living the Christian life faithfully today. One of them is relying on the power of the Holy Spirit to doing that. But Paul is talking about the other one in this passage because it's the other key to Christian living that Paul wants to give us is he wants to give us the gift of hope, right? He wants to give us the gift of hope. He wants to give us the gift of perspective. Give us a gift of confidence, knowing that God has already won the battle and that one day Christ will return. And again, maybe it helps you to think about it in terms of World War II. Think about what the experience of individual soldiers would have been like based on when it was they enlisted in the war. So let's say that you turned 18 in late December of 1941. So you go ahead and enlist, and this is right after Pearl Harbor. Well, if you enlisted then, that is still 3 years before D-Day takes place. There is a lot of uncertainty because you don't know how this war is going to end. There's a lot of fear. There's a lot of questions around that. But I would imagine it's a very different experience if you turn 18, let's say in late December of 1944, and you enlist then. Because at that point, D-Day is already 6 months in the rearview mirror. At that point, news outlets are starting to talk about, hey, it's just a matter of time. There's no way that the Nazis can do this. And so if you joined up then, there was still work to be done. And it absolutely still required real courage to enlist and to fight in the final year of that war. But I think you would fight with a different level of confidence because you know how the story is going to end. And this is why. This is why Paul ties the command to love to the truth that Christ is going to return. Because he knows that until Jesus comes back, there are going to be rough times. He knows that until Jesus comes back, we're going to face discouragement. He knows that until Jesus comes back, we're going to have to love people in situations that it's very difficult to love them in. And he knows that just as people, we have a tendency to get discouraged. So if we lose sight of the fact that our story ends with Jesus coming back, if we lose sight of the fact that ultimately we are on the winning side, he's afraid that we can get discouraged and that we can stop relying every day on the power of the Holy Spirit. And that some of us might just decide to kind of put up the white flag and just surrender in the midst of it all. So Paul reminds them that they have hope. They have confidence because Christ has already come. The battle has already been won. One day he's going to return and write the last chapter of the story. So Paul wants them to remember, don't give up. Live in light of the fact that D-Day has happened, that God has won the victory. You see, Paul wants us to never, never, ever forget that Jesus will in fact come back one day. In fact, if you look at the very end of the letter of Romans, like where we started this series in chapter 16, near the end of that letter, Paul works in like one last reminder of this truth just before it closes out. So in chapter 16, right, he's just greeting like 25, 30 people by name. And he's, oh, mention this person. Hey, tell this person I said hello. He's doing all these personal greetings. And then kind of out of nowhere, this is what he says. He says, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. Now, if you're reading through chapter 16 as a whole, that can seem a little bit out of place. Peter's like, hey, greet Priscilla and Aquila. Oh, greet my buddy Andronicus. By the way, God is going to crush Satan. Oh, Tertius is here. He wanted to make sure that we said hello to so-and-so. And at first you're like, wait, how does that even fit in with what he's saying? But it's not a throwaway line. Instead, I think what Paul is doing is he's realizing this is one of my last reminders. To remind the people of Rome that they cannot give up. To remind them of the truth that God is going to come back, that they are on the winning side. He wants to make sure that they do not lose sight of that eternal perspective. Yes, there is truth that we still have a battle to fight, but we can have hope in the truth that God has won the war and that someday he is going to be coming back. You see, for Paul, the strength to live the Christian life comes from looking back. From remembering what it is that God has done for us in Christ, from remembering that the power of the Holy Spirit is available to us and taking advantage of that. But it also comes from looking forward, right? From remembering that Jesus is going to come back one day, just as he promised, and that can give us hope in the present moment, right? Those are the two keys that we find in this book that can help us live faithfully each and every day. And we can all benefit from looking back to what God has done. And we can all benefit and find encouragement from looking forward to what God has promised to do. And in some ways, that idea of looking forward, like we were talking about that at the perfect time, because next week is the first Sunday in Advent, right? Advent is a 4-week season that the church engages in as we prepare to celebrate the birth of Jesus as Christmas. But the interesting thing about Advent, right, a lot of Advent is about looking back to what happened in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. But the first Sunday of Advent is when the church historically has looked forward, not to the time Christ came into the past, but to the promised time when Christ will return. So this idea, the fact that he has come in the past, that he's coming in the future, that's what we're turning our eyes towards in the next sermon series. And ultimately, the fact that he is coming back, that is where our hope for the present has to be found, that one day Christ is going to return and rule this world and fix this mess. Right, our hope for our lives and for our families and for our world is based on that. And any person or any government or any system that promises to deliver paradise without God is ultimately going to fall short. Right, if we put our trust for this world in anything other than God, ultimately, we're in for a big disappointment. And that goes for good things too, right? Like investing in movements for needed social change, for voting, whatever it might be. We've got to remember that only God can bring his perfect rule to this planet. But we have to balance that acknowledgement and that truth with the fact that we cannot forget our divine calling to be salt and light to this world, right? As we wait, we work. Right? Knowing that Christ will return one day, that everything is going to be made right, that His justice will finally come in the future. That should give us a passion for justice and for holiness now that gets translated into action. That is how all of the biblical authors understood it. That's why Paul, in another one of his letters, as he encourages us to step out and move in love and the power of the Holy Spirit, tells us this. He says that we can always give ourselves fully to the work of the Lord because we know that our labor in the Lord is not in vain. So here's the challenge for each of us today. As you go through your week, I want to invite you to pray that God would help you understand the present time. Right? Understanding the present time means we know that only God can truly rescue us. Understanding the present time helps us know that one day God is going to return, but until then, we have the power of His Holy Spirit living in us. Understanding the present time should drive us in every situation that we're in to ask the question, what does love require of me? Knowing that His Spirit can help us and that answering that question will inevitably push us into action, into working to build for His kingdom. So let's pray that God would indeed answer that question for us today. God, thank you so much for the truth that we find in the book of Romans. Thank you that the power of your Holy Spirit is alive and at work in us. Thank you, God, that even for people who are as forgetful as I am, there's just one question that we've got to hang on to, one question that can guide us in all that we do. What does love require of me? God, as we go through this week, would you help us answer that question well? We look back, we recognize what you've done, and we recognize that your Holy Spirit lives in us and can help us hear from you and answer that. We look forward to the future and know that one day you will return, so we've got hope in the present. But God, would you show us in whatever situation we're facing what your love is inviting us to do? And then would you, in your power, give us the courage to step out in doing it, knowing that anything that we do as we work for the Lord, that work is not in vain. We ask these things in your name, Lord. Amen. So thanks for being with us today. We just trust you have an incredible week and we look forward to seeing you soon.